Hi everyone, I am Kimberly, the 5-Minute NP. The 5-Minute NP was born out of my belief that small, incremental changes can drastically change the trajectory of your life. Our genes do not have to determine our lifespan. My goal through this podcast is to act as a roadmap that bridges the gap between knowledge and action, leading to you living your healthiest, happiest, longest life. Welcome to the 5-Minute NP Podcast. Hello everyone, welcome to the 5-Minute NP. On today's episode, I spoke with Marta Zaroska. Marta is a science journalist, travel writer, and ghostwriter who has been published in the Washington Post, Scientific American, the Boston Globe, and the National Geographic Traveler. Marta discusses her latest and best-selling book, Growing Young, How Friendship, Optimism, and Kindness Can Help You Live to 100. In addition, she talks about how one of the most important things you can do to increase your lifespan is have a committed relationship. Marta is full of knowledge, and the information she shares on the podcast is truly life-changing. Welcome to the 5-Minute NP Podcast. Hi, Marta. How are you?
Hi. Nice to meet you.
You too. First of all, congratulations on the success of your book, Growing Young. It's now a bestseller. Is that right?
Yes, it's a bestseller according to Globe and Mail. That's correct. Yes.
That's awesome. You've received some major endorsements too. Dan Butner from The Blue Zones, Joshua Becker, The Minimalist, and a lot of them. That's awesome.
Yes, that was pretty nice. So many people, you know, believing in Growing Young and so on, giving their endorsements was really, really great.
Yeah. Well, I think during these times, I mean, this information is, you know, relevant. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Yes. Okay.
So you have a diverse background. You were a lawyer, is that right? Then a science journalist, yes. Author?
I mean, I finished law school, but that was over 20 years ago. So
wow, that's pretty amazing.
But I've been a science journalist even longer than that. So I'm first and foremost a science journalist.
Yeah. And a wife and a mom. Is your daughter named Ellie?
Yes, that's right. How do you know?
Well, in the book. Yes. In the book. But my daughter's named Ellie, and we spell it the same way.
All right. Awesome.
Yeah. So this is actually your second book, right? The first one is about meat, right? Our obsession with meat.
Yes, it's called Meat Hooked, the History and Science of Our 2.5 Million Years Obsession with Meat. That's right.
Wow. So this, how did your journey progress to discussing Growing Young?
I mean, it's not far at all because, yeah. As you know, I've been a journalist for many years. I've been writing about nutrition and health and psychology for the Washington Post, the Scientific American. And my first book, Meat Hooked, it is about nutrition as well. It's about the food, meat in particular, and why we love eating it so much. And it is not really far away to go from there to how important our diet and exercise are versus other drivers of longevity. Well, and this is what I write in Growing Young. And I show that diet and nutrition are not as important as we tend to think sometimes compared to things such as kindness, friendship, romantic relationship, optimism. And although I never say that diet and exercise are not important, because that's absolutely not the case, they are important, but sometimes we just completely forget about other things and put too much maybe into fad diets and miracle foods and things like that, and not pay attention to how we live our lives socially and, let's say, mentally.
Mm-hmm. I think what's great is your book. I think it's important for people to realize that it is back from science. It is, you know, you took a lot of research out of the gold standards of research, which is the meta-analysis, which is huge because it really does back up what you're saying. It's just not, you know, optimism makes you live longer. I mean, there is really a lot of research in this area. And you've traveled, you know, what, like 80 countries or whatever, lived in like 6 different ones. I mean, you have a lot of experience in this area. And were you surprised at the amount of research there was on this topic?
I was indeed. You know, when I first came across some of the first studies I've read on this, and some of them were this exactly meta-analysis comparing how diet and exercise stands among things like friendship, optimism, social integration, and so on. And I was indeed very surprised to see that there are hundreds, thousands of studies that have been conducted, very serious research on neurobiology and aging and all the hormones in our bodies. And there was animal research and human research and epidemiological research and in vitro research. There was like all the possible types of research in these areas. Lots and lots of scientists. I've talked to dozens of them as well when I was researching the book. And there is sometimes when people hear exactly that optimism or friendship or kindness can make you live longer and stay healthy, they automatically assume it's some kind of new agey stuff, but it's nothing like that. It's really very rooted in our physiology. And the reason for that is that we are social apes. We evolved to be socially connected. And so our bodies function the best when we are with others.
Right. I love what you say about the purpose for writing Growing Young. And I thought I would just say it. I wrote Growing Young out of the belief that in the deluge of reductionist wellness news, we've somehow lost the big picture, ignoring the things that matter most for longevity, relationships, emotions, and our psyche. That's pretty great summary of why you wrote this book and how important this is to our longevity.
Yeah, you know, I think that sometimes, and I was guilty of that myself, that we look too much into exactly what best fruit or vegetable of the month I should be eating, or what kind of diet, you know, avoiding gluten, going keto, paleo, you know, whatever. There are so many things out there, and we really love to also measure things. And this is one of the reasons why I think that this kind of message that optimism, kindness, and friendship are important for our health hasn't really reached the public so far. And the reason for that is that exactly we are so into measuring and counting. We love to know if we have eaten enough ounces of our broccoli per day. You know, you can just put it on the scales and know. You can measure how many steps you've taken today with your exercise gadget. Whereas with friendship or kindness, it's much more nuanced. As you know, are you kind enough? Are you empathetic enough? Are you optimistic enough? It's much harder. And also the other thing is that there is nothing for anyone to sell you here, because with diets and food products and exercise gadgets and supplements and vitamins, there are companies that are making money on that, and this is why this message is reaching people. Whereas with exactly, you know, you cannot really sell or make money on telling people to go for a walk with their friends. You know, there's nothing to sell here. So, and when there is money, there is no marketing, and yeah, the message is not so widespread.
Wow, that's a great point. Well, how did this information impact you in your own life?
I mean, I definitely see certain things, such as, for example, sitting on the couch with my husband and just chatting, as actually health behavior. You know, in the past, I used to think that whenever I skipped my run, exactly just to sit down with a glass of wine and just talk about our days, I felt I was kind of, you know, sacrificing something a little bit, you know, my kind of health habits and for my just pleasure. But now I see that this is at least as important, if not more, because actually having a happy marriage is the most important, or happy romantic relationship is the most important thing you can do for your health and longevity. So I definitely don't see skipping my runs. I still run, but some kind of sacrifice for my health.
Yeah, I can relate to that. It's always like, it might just be the woman thing. It's like, I have so much to do. I need to get this done. I don't have time to sit down. I don't have time to relax. But yet by doing that, we are improving our health more than, you know, trying to get all that other stuff done.
I also simplified our eating a lot as well. You know, as you mentioned before, I have a daughter. She just turned 8. And when she was younger, I was really, really obsessed about healthy eating in a way that I now see might have been too obsessive. So I was always looking for the best vegetable I could buy her, you know, whatever. It was heritage tomatoes. It couldn't just be tomatoes. It had to be heritage, organic, and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And always scouring the internet for the best recipes that would combine the most of the best in one dish kind of thing, yeah. You know, adding chia seeds to her smoothies and stuff like that. And now I really know that it's not necessary. It's too much. You know, healthy eating is in a way quite simple. It just, if you get your portions of fruits and vegetables, if you have junk food and too much sugar, you know, you'll be fine. It's just like Michael Pollan said, right? Eat food, mostly plants, not too much. That's right. That simple. So right. I certainly simplified that, and we no longer eat organic kale, but you know, carrots and cauliflower are perfectly fine. But I do see things like conscientiousness, for example, teaching my child how to be conscientious or kind and helping in her community as actually very important for her health and her longevity.
Yeah, that's true. I think it's also important to, or impactful to start with some statistics that you mentioned. So I think it will be a big eye opener for me to kind of go over some of these statistics and just will demonstrate the significance of your research from this book. So you talk about how these are the things that can lower mortality risk. So exercise can decrease the mortality risk by, you know, 23 to 33%. Compared to a happy marriage, 49%. That's impressive. Fruits and vegetables, meaning like six or more servings a day, you say can change mortality 26% estimately, compared to a large social network can decrease it by 45%. And also you talk about exercise in here. But overall, I mean, that just paints the big picture and how important these relationships are for us.
Yeah, exactly. No, I never say that we should be sticking to those numbers, you know, literally, because it really depends on the study and so on. But the big picture, as you've said, is there, right? That the social part, maybe even more important, as you mentioned, your diet and exercise do lower your mortality. They are important, but maybe not as important and not the only important thing that we should be doing for our health and longevity.
In the beginning of your book, I think it is, first of all, you do a great job. You kind of start out talking about basically what people are prioritizing and the stress that we put on ourselves in our 30s, 40s, 50s, you know, such as financial worries. And but you talk about how these things can actually, you know, shorten our lifespan and erode our telomeres and also the effect of loneliness on longevity.
Yes, you know, social isolation and loneliness are one of the biggest longevity and health wreckers, unfortunately. People who are socially isolated not only are 2 to 3 times more likely to die prematurely than those who are not socially isolated, but they even have shorter telomeres, you know, those kind of protective caps on the ends of your chromosomes that are that take important part in the aging process. So you can see very direct biological effects in your body. You know, they even on, for example, on your blood pressure. So people who are socially isolated, chronically isolated year after year, they on average see an increase in their blood pressure following that social isolation. So there are so many different things that happen in your body when you're isolated, which of course makes it a very difficult topic these days, because there are so many of us who are isolating for very good reasons. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, our bodies don't really like being alone.
Right. Yeah, I was going to bring that up. I mean, the quarantine and the, you know, we're trying to stay away from people so we don't get this virus. But yet, you know, in your book, you talk about how, you know, when we're alone or loneliness, we're actually more at risk for getting a virus.
Yeah, I mean, in a way, because we're more at risk of getting sick with the virus if we get it, because actually our antiviral response is sensitive to social isolation. So people who are socially isolated have a worse antiviral response. So it means that if they actually get exposed to certain viruses, of course, this particular coronavirus was not studied yet in this regard, right. But other viruses have, like rhinoviruses, for example, and that they will be more likely to fall sick. And even how often you get hugged matters. So people who don't get often many hugs have also worse immune response, which is again worrisome in terms of what's happening now. But I'm absolutely not saying we should start hugging and you know, stop. Right. Social distancing, because it's necessary these days,
right?
But unfortunately there are side effects. So maybe, you know, for people who already live with someone, they can put extra effort into hugging their children, their spouses, their housemates, just to get this kind of boost of oxytocin and for their immune systems.
Yeah, that's a great idea. In the first chapter, you discuss aging and different therapies and theories of aging, why women live longer than men, and how we might not be able to simplify the aging process by just trying to lengthen our telomeres, which anyone that studies longevity, I mean, this is kind of a huge area. Can you briefly talk about why we age physically, maybe why some of these miracle therapies that are currently being attempted might, you know, we shouldn't focus on those, like say metformin, which is a kind of a huge one these days?
I mean, first of all, nobody knows yet for sure how we age and why we age. If you ask longevity aging experts and scientists who study the area, they'll tell you that we don't really know yet. So still, we're just beginning to scratch the surface and so on. So on, there are many theories running around. And so, of course, telomeres play a role in aging process, but they are also not everything, and their role is also quite complicated and not just simple as you have shorter telomeres, you will live shorter. It's not that simple. We have also other aging clocks like the DNA methylation clock, so it's there are so many things going on there, and this is also the reason why those simple take this pill and live longer things just don't work yet, and most likely won't for many, many years, because we don't really understand what's happening, we don't know the long-term effects, and just trying to pop something hoping it will stop you from aging is just mostly dangerous in fact, and we don't know what kind of side effects and can happen. And many of these treatments are starting to show up side effects that are very, very worrying. And some of the experts I've talked with said that they would never, ever take metformin or other pills like that or drugs like that, precisely because we don't know what can happen down the road.
Yeah, that's a great point. I love how you say there's no longevity pill, so don't obsess over telomeres and lifespan tests. And but if you want to live longer, find a good romantic relationship or a partner and volunteer.
Yeah, you know, and then, you know, to exactly things like friendships or being kind and helping and engaging your community, these things don't have some, you know, nasty side effects. They just don't, you know. They will not damage your liver as a side effect. So it's definitely much, much safer and much more tested by science to engage in those things as a health habit.
You're so right. And it's so much, honestly, it's just less stressful. I mean, it's hard to keep up with all the stuff that's coming out. Okay, I gotta go jump in the, you know, the cool water, and then I gotta go to the sauna, and then I gotta, you know, it's like a lot of work. So, I mean, just by practicing random acts of kindness and being kinder to your partner, I mean, these things, you know, can really be a lot simpler, like you said, cheaper, and overall just better for your health.
And more fun in general. I don't know, but I don't like cold showers. So.
I know. I mean, that one, that's a little rough. So also, I wanted to kind of just jump in. I mean, this is a huge process talking about the physiological effects. Could you just kind of talk about how our minds talk with our body, the mind-body connection, and, you know, the physiological response with the HPA access? I know that's just kind of a big area, but just kind of like, you know, break it down in simpler terms and how it, when it's chronically elevated, it affects us.
Yeah, so we have, you know, there are many different ways in which our minds and our bodies are connected, and it's, and they are also interconnected within themselves. So it's all a very complicated system. But some parts of the system, for example, are so-called social hormones. So we have the famous oxytocin, the laugh hormone, how we usually call it. You have the serotonin, which is often you call the feel-good hormone. You have endorphins, you have vasopressin, for example. And all these hormones connect the way you live your life socially and mentally with downstream physiological effects. So for example, oxytocin, which you get, for example, from looking deeply into the eyes of your friends, family, or your beloved one, or even your dog, also can affect your bone health or your inflammation processes in your body. Endorphins, which you get, for example, by doing things in synchrony with other people in particular, so like things like dancing synchronously or singing in a choir or jogging in sync with another person, they are also, for example, natural painkillers. So all these kind of hormones, they act both on our minds and our bodies. Then you have, as you've mentioned yourself, the HPA axis, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. And this is part of our stress response or fight and flight response that we evolved to you know, fight and flight predators or enemies on the savanna, and which unfortunately very often malfunctions in our modern lives when the stresses are much more chronic, maybe low burning, but very long term. Mm-hmm. And this is basically something that starts the processes start in your brain with the hypothalamus and your amygdala, the fear center. And then there is like a downstream cascade of hormones that get released into your body that includes things like cortisol, the famous stress hormone. And then they affect your body in certain ways, which if it's chronic, these can be very negative damage, you know, the cortisol, for example, sometimes even called like the stress, the health enemy number one, because it's involved in many different diseases, the so-called civilization diseases like diabetes, cardiovascular problems, cancer even. So, on the other hand, when you are caring for other people, when you are being kind, when you are connected with others, this stress axis, you could say, calm down, and you'd have less of the cortisol release or less adrenaline release, and your body generally functions better.
Yeah, so it's so important. I think like when you understand the physiological aspect of it, you can start to understand why doing these other things, how it affects that, you know, because hormones play a big part in a lot of different things. So I think just having an understanding of that can help people better understand why, you know, doing things that cause less stress and, you know, being kind to others, you can see how that all affects you physically and mentally.
Yeah, you know, even simple thing like kindness, which again sounds very new agey, but for example, there are studies showing that when you engage in acts of kindness, very simple acts, even things like opening doors for others, making a coffee for your spouse, or baking cookies for your neighbor, these things can actually affect us on the level of our blood. You can see the differences in leukocytes of people who are engaging in acts of kindness versus those who don't do things like that. So these are very, very basic, very physiological effects.
I think you did something where you kind of measured your cortisol levels, performed random acts of kindness, and you did see an improvement somewhat on that level. So that was kind of fun to do, I'm sure.
Yeah, so it was an experiment. I mean, experiment is a big word for a sample of one, but there are actually proper studies on more people that have similar results, but I just wanted to see it on myself. And I was helped by scientists from King's College London who did all the lab work for me. They sent me a bunch of cortisol swabs. I had to chew on them 3 times a day, which was extremely unpleasant. And then on certain days, I was just living my life as normal. And on other days, I would engage in those acts of kindness. So every morning I would sit down and think, okay, what nice things can I do to people today? Which was actually amazingly fun and pleasant thing to do to begin with. And afterwards, when the scientists analyzed my cortisol levels, they discovered that on the days when I was doing the kindness intervention, my cortisol was behaving in a much healthier way, because it's not as simple as to say that I had less of it. It's about how it changes throughout the day. And my cortisol response was much, much better on the days of kindness, even though on one of those days I was very stressed for just personal reasons, but it just didn't affect me as negatively as it would on the biological level, as if I probably wasn't doing all these kind things at the same time.
That's powerful, really, when you think about it. You know, a lot of us keep a gratitude journal. I mean, the effects of gratitude on us are amazing as well. So I was thinking, you know, keeping a journal, it would be great to start your day with, you know, gratitude and what can you do to be kind today? What things can you do to be closer to your partner, to better your relationship? Maybe tie that all in together. I was thinking, wow, the benefits of your health, if we could just start our day with that in mind.
You know, it's when you're talking about your partner, even as simple things as not rolling your eyes, there's actual research on that showing that when people roll their eyes at their partners, which is a sign of a certain mental attitude and relationship kind of dynamic going on, that this actually causes us to deterioration of our metabolism to the point that we metabolize fats worse and may gain weight. So if you want to stay slim, don't roll your eyes at other people.
It all comes back. You know, you stay in shape, you have a better relationship. Well, let's talk about a few things. I want to just kind of jump into, hear your thoughts. You talk about in the book, the power of sex, massage, and relationships. and the role of social hormones here, especially oxytocin.
Yeah, so oxytocin is the big one here, obviously. And so massages and sex are all exactly about oxytocin, although serotonin there is also involved as well. But when we touch basically other people, we get the release of oxytocin, which is exactly this love hormone that makes us feel all warm and cuddly and trusting, but also, on the other hand, has all those downstream physiological effects. And this is one of the ways in which hugging, closeness, has potentially beneficial effects on our health.
Well, you know, with the divorce rate in America being well over 50%, I feel like if more people realize the significance of these things on our health and longevity, maybe we would work harder to make our relationships work, invest more time in them.
I mean, you know, there is certainly nothing worse than divorce per se, but because it's about, you know, if you manage to find somebody else, you will have a happy relationship afterwards. It's, you know, all good for you. It's just as long as you have someone like that. And definitely working more on our relationship is extremely important. And in Growing Young, I also give lots of tips on how to do that. I've talked to some marriage experts to find out. And I also implemented it myself. It was also a lot of fun. So which included going to an amusement park with my husband and going on roller coasters. A great marriage boost thing. So yes, it's if we only put as much effort into our relationships, both romantic ones and friendships and our neighborly relationships and so on, as we do into looking for diets and exercise and downloading apps to make our, you know, abdominals stronger and things like that, I certainly think our health would only benefit.
Yeah. I also think it's interesting when you talk about oxytocin, you know, you talk about it can, you know, even improve like faithfulness, or, you know, that, you know, if the oxytocin and the trust is high between you as a couple, they may, you know, might be less likely to, you know, engage in unfaithfulness or, you know, whatever you were talking about. You know, maybe they would stand a little further away from a pretty woman. I thought that was funny.
I mean, there is research on how oxytocin sprays. So it's something that looks basically like kind of nose spray, something, nose decongestant you use when you have a cold. You spray it into your nose. I've tried it. And it causes all these effects on us, including that if you spray oxytocin into the noses of husbands, they will stay further up away from pretty women than if you don't do that. So it is very interesting. And yes, you can buy those things on the internet, but please don't, once again. It's really only used for research purposes. And don't replace old school hugging with some kind of miracle over-the-counter untested products.
I thought that was good. When it comes to diet, I felt like you brought to light some great points. You talked about, you know, how we obsess over being gluten-free, superfoods, high-protein, low-carb diets, organic foods, our weight, and even supplements, and how really all of that is not even as important, and in the case of supplements, can even be dangerous for us, why it's more important to invest in our mind and our relationships compared to all of those things.
No, an average American spends $56 on supplements, and that's an average. There are certainly people who spend much, much more on that. Yeah. And it is worrisome because these products are mostly uncontrolled and untested and not the same. They're not the same as drugs, because drugs have to be really go through many, many hoops to be approved and controlled. Mm-hmm. Whereas supplements, you know, nobody really knows what's in them. And sometimes you can find heavy metals in them, like mercury, for example, or you can find other pharmaceutical pollution in them and contamination. I mean, and also we don't really know how they interact with each other. So we don't really know what we are popping. I also used to give my daughter multivitamin pills in the past. I thought I was doing a good, great thing for her, but then the more I read, I realized that this is not good at all. At best, it's doing nothing, but it potentially is doing harm. There are actual studies showing that when people pop multivitamin pills, they actually live shorter than those who don't do that. So it's definitely something to think about.
Wow. And I thought it was interesting, you're talking about the gluten-free, like, there's probably 1% of people that actually have the celiacs or the autoimmune disease. and why actually everybody trying to do gluten-free, there's actually more processing that goes on trying to get things to be gluten-free than just eating the gluten if you can tolerate it.
Yeah, exactly. You know, there are certainly people who should be gluten-free and they have medical conditions, but unfortunately, eating those foods has also side effects. And whereas if you have celiac disease, of course, you don't have no other choice, and this is better for you still. But these foods are more highly processed. They have more often more sugar in them or other additives to just glue the foods together. Because when you remove gluten, it tastes worse. It holds up worse. They also tend to have much less vitamins in them, the natural vitamins, not the multivitamin kind. So in general, you know, they are lower quality. So you should definitely think twice before just going gluten for just to try it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought that was great information. And even, you know, superfoods and all of those things, it's not that you're saying that's bad, don't do it. I mean, I think it's mainly don't obsess about it. You know, don't feel guilty about, you know, maybe having, you know, relaxing a little bit on that, knowing that when you're investing in all these other things, those are the drivers of longevity over stressing about all of these other little things.
Yeah, so a friend asked me recently, she said that because I often talk about goji berries in my book, and she was like, but should I stop eating goji berries? I love goji berries. And I told her, absolutely not. If you love goji berries, just eat your goji berries. You know, it's awesome. You know, if you love strawberries, eat strawberries. If you love goji berries, eat goji berries. But don't expect them to make you miraculously live long. They're, you know, if you enjoy them, that's perfect. But they are not, they don't want to do any miracles here. Not any more than cherries or apples.
Yeah, I actually like the goji berries too. I eat them every day in my nut mix. So I thought that was funny when you were talking about that. Well, let's talk a little bit about, you talk a lot about loneliness. You devote a whole entire chapter to it, and you kind of touched on that a little bit ago. I think it's hard when you think about loneliness. A lot of people in this day and age with technology and even in relationships can experience loneliness. What is it about loneliness that causes us to, what happens with loneliness? What's it doing to us?
So loneliness is something they often compare to hunger. It's a signal that you don't have enough social connection in your life. And just like hunger tells you that you don't have enough food in your life and that you should do something about it. So per se, there is nothing wrong with the feeling of loneliness. It's just a signal to your body that, you know, maybe you should review what's happening. And in the past, when we were lonely, when we were socially isolated, that usually also changed, it served a purpose. Because when you were with your tribe on the savannah and you were socially isolated, that meant that you were all alone. Probably either you had a fight with your tribe, they kicked you out for some reason, and now you're on your own, you know, in a very dangerous place full of predators, and potentially, you know, you could fall, you could have wounds, you could get injured. Whereas on the other hand, we're much more likely to catch viruses, because we catch viruses, as we now know very well, from other humans. So if you're away from other humans, you're much less likely to catch them. And because our bodies are so constructed that they save energy, they try not to run systems that are not of much use. So when we were away from our tribe, alone in the savannah, the antiviral response would be tuned down, like kind of turned down, you could say, because it was no longer that needed. But our antibacterial response would be turned up, because we're much more likely to get a wound from, I don't know, a scratch from a lion or by falling and scratching your leg, which could get infected by bacteria. So your inflammation had to go up. And these days, this is problematic, because we are socially isolated for different reasons. We are not alone on the savannah. And while when our inflammation goes up chronically, it's a bad thing these days, because it can lead to diabetes, to cardiovascular problems, and so on. So this is why the systems that were designed to help us in the past these days are misfiring and actually causing us problems. And also, this is one of the reasons, for example, why people, when they are socially isolated or being lonely, they're actually sleeping worse. And this also has biological reasons, because again, when you were alone on the savannah, it made sense to sleep poorly, to be very, you know, kind of very shallowly and being very attentive to every possible noise. It could have been the predator, you know, creeping up on you. But it doesn't make sense when you're sleeping, you know, alone in your bed in Manhattan, you know, feeling lonely and sleeping poorly, awaiting a lion to creep into your room. So But these are biological processes that evolved to help us, but yes, they are not well designed for 21st century.
Well, I feel like many people have social anxiety, difficulty making friends. I think this is scary when you think about the impact on longevity. And even you mentioned being an introvert, which I was like, oh no, I've always thought I was a little bit of an introvert. I'm like, now this can infect my longevity. But so that kind of scared me a little bit. But I think what I'm asking is, what can we do if we have social anxiety? Because now even thinking about our longevity, we can get anxious about, now we got to be more social. I mean, what are things that we can do to improve that area of our lives, to get better about making friends, to become more extroverted maybe?
I mean, it's not necessarily that much about extroversion, introversion, even though there are some small effects, but it's not really about that. And often people ask me, you know, but that I'm not a party animal. I don't like that. And the thing is, you don't have to at all. This is not what the research is saying. It's not saying that you have to be, you know, going to crowded places with lots of people and be the star of the evening. Absolutely not. It's all about being connected. And also there is the same with the number of friends. Also, I'm often asked how many friends should you have to be fine. And again, there is no perfect number. It really depends on what you need. For some people, for example, having just one very, very close friend is all they need, and they really feel satisfied when they can feel that they have someone they can rely on and is there for them always. And for another person, one friend will not be enough. They'll need three or even five very close friends to have their needs satisfied. And as long as you feel that you do have that you are satisfied, then you are perfectly fine. And absolutely, there is no need for, again, big crowds and parties. And the same with connecting with others. In general, it is good to be connected with lots of people, but you don't have to meet everybody at the same time. For introverts, they can have perfectly fine relationships one-on-one, so you can meet your neighbors, but not all at the same time, just, you know, one at a time with coffee and in a quiet place. And this is perfectly, absolutely fine. So this is the difference between introverts and extroverts. It's not about being a social, right?
Yeah. I thought that was interesting. Also, just you gave some ideas, and I thought, yeah, because some people aren't really good with connecting with others. You know, we're busy in our lives. We don't make the time for it. You know, maybe going to lunch with a friend or just reaching out, actually, just saying, hey, do you want to go to lunch? I mean, sometimes people struggle with that. So I thought it was great how you gave some suggestions on how to do that. Maybe, you know, make an effort to talk to the neighbor, maybe take time to set up a lunch, just making it more of a priority.
I think that's the most important thing, to just change the way we think, right? So considering, maybe even put in your diary, how much time are you spending on looking at your diet and what you're eating and your exercise, and how much time are you putting into your friendship, your connections, your neighbors, your relationships, your family? You know, how much really are you putting in there? And because we are expecting, you know, results without any effort, and it doesn't work like that. You know, with friendship, for example, as you said, in my book, I also offer lots of tips, very practical ones, how to, you know, help your relationships. And of course, the most important is just do it, and, you know, meet your friends, put the time away. But also, for example, such simple things as asking for favors, actually, that people really connect better when you ask them for help. People like to help, and it really gives a boost to relationships when you ask to be helped. So not necessarily even help yourself, but just ask others to help you, and that's really supports connection and relationships.
That's great. What about, you talk about empathy, attachment, and so why is empathy and attachment in the way we treat others so important to our longevity?
That's because not only that empathy can have very direct physiological effects on you, but also because it's kind of the founding stone underneath lots of other things. So, you know, people who are high on empathy have better relationships, they have stronger friendships, they are much more likely to volunteer, to donate money, to be kind and helpful to begin with. So empathy is kind of root of everything. And the thing is that empathy, even though it does have some small genetic compounds, and it's is also something that we can really work on. And you know, when people hear that empathy is part of the genetic, they're like, oh, okay, I'm doomed. But the thing is, you know, when you think about your muscles or your exercise, it's also quite in a large part determined genetically. I will never be as strong as my husband, you know, for example. My muscles are just not that strong, and even no matter how much exercise, I will not achieve the same results. And yet I'm still trying, right? I don't give up because I'm born with some worse genetic makeup. And it's the same with empathy. We can really, really develop the skill. And there is lots of research showing that, and some amazing organizations I've actually met and worked and observed at work who teach empathy, for example, to children in classrooms. And it's a skill that really, really can be developed. And even by such simple things as when you go out, for example, I don't know, you see a waitress in a restaurant when you are dining, and just spends 2 minutes thinking about her life, like, who is she? Is she happy today? Does she look tired? What is she thinking about? You know, it's just such a simple exercise, but when you try to see the world from other people's view, it really develops the skill, and it doesn't require a lot of effort, really just a few minutes a day, and you can see improvements. Or even reading books is also great for empathy, like novels or some very powerful emotionally movies as well. This all helps our empathy.
Which I think we do need to work on that in today's society. I think that's great that you talk about it as something you can learn, because I think a lot of people are like, I'm just not empathetic. But it's like, no, you're saying, no, this is something you can work on, and it will improve your health to work on it.
Yeah, no, it's just it's exactly for me, just like saying, you know, I have weak muscles. That's it.
Right? That's it. Yeah. Well, let's move into meditation and mindfulness. How does this boost our health?
Yes, so meditation and mindfulness are important as well. Although if you were to choose between your relationship and mindfulness, go for relationships, not mindfulness. It's the effects are much stronger with volunteering or relationships than with mindfulness. But it's also helpful. It's more or less on the level of diet and exercise. The long-term meditators, for example, they even have brains that work differently. You can see it on fMRI scans. They breathe differently. They even blink in a different pattern than people who don't meditate. So you can see very powerful physiological changes through meditation and mindfulness.
Is there a certain amount of time that you know, you're supposed to meditate, or is it just really taking a couple minutes out of your day? Can that improve your health if you can just learn to do it even a couple minutes a day?
I mean, definitely there is a difference if you do it, the more you do it and the longer you do it. There is no denying it that, you know, you cannot say that somebody who does it an hour a day for 10 years is exactly the same as 5 minutes a day for 1 month. It's not. But definitely, you know, you have to start somewhere, and doing a little bit is better than doing nothing. So, so even trying a little bit is already a good thing.
I hope this is something that you can work on too, because no matter how much I try it, my mind just wanders. I'm like, you know, it's difficult sometimes to stop everything and, you know, just meditate.
Yeah, but that's what they, you know, the meditation experts say. Your mind is not really supposed to stop wandering. You're just supposed to observe how it wanders, right? And don't criticize yourself for it. So with compassion.
So why is having a purpose in life so important to our longevity?
Yes, so purpose in life is one of those big things exactly that matter really for how long and healthy you live. And this is something that I've learned in particular in Japan, because they are really big on acknowledging purpose in life as one of the health and longevity drivers. Even when, you know, when you talk, for example, to longevity researchers in the West, they usually talk about diet and exercise and things like that. Whereas in Japan, purpose in life, or what they call ikigai, is one of the very first things that comes up. Even in official health ministry documents, when they are analyzing why certain areas of Japan have better health and longevity than others, they actually quote purpose in life as a driver of longevity and health. So this is something that they really, really appreciate. And there is research as well in the West also showing that people who have purpose in life are healthier and live longer than those who don't have this ikigai.
Yeah, that's important. And I think it's really becoming more apparent. I think we're hearing a lot more about this, you know, finding your why, finding your purpose. Why do you get up every morning? And you can see really why that can affect your health, as opposed to just, you know, having nothing, no reason to why you're even here, what you're doing.
And, you know, just one important thing about ikigai is that it's generally involves doing, giving something back and doing something for others. Because I've also heard people ask me, you know, can golfing be your purpose in life? And I said, I'm afraid this is not what it's about. It's about something that you, even in a very small way, but kind of contribute to something. So for example, the Japanese people usually say that their children or their grandchildren are the ikigai, or that, I don't know, keeping their neighborhoods flowers is their ikigai, mm-hmm. or you know, running a bakery is their ikigai, or just anything, like, you know, any way you kind of contribute to the community, to others, is, no matter how small, is, it can be an ikigai. But definitely just only about you, then it doesn't really work that well.
I was going to say something. I don't remember what I was going to say about that. But yeah, I know. I wanted to talk about a little bit about retirement. I read somewhere that, you know, on average, after we retire, we may have like 6 years. So I loved how you talk about the importance of that and staying, you know, just keep working till you drop, I think is what you were saying. And why is it
not exactly, but yeah.
You know, it's the idea of really continuing on, even if it's doing like volunteering or staying active, just continuing on to do something can improve your health and longevity.
I think it's very much connected to this ikigai or this purpose in life. So once again, you absolutely don't have to keep working, although that may work for some people, but it's not about continuing your job. And again, once again, in Japan, for example, they are big on something called silver hair jobs, is what I also describe. I visited a so-called silver hair employment agency. And this is an employment agency that caters only to people after official retirement age. So they will retire from their normal careers as, I don't know, bankers or in marketing or journalism or whatnot. And then they come to the silver hair employment agency and they look for very simple, non-demanding jobs, such as, for example, being a parking attendant or helping children cross streets from school or attending to the public greenery, for example, as a gardener. And they don't do it for money at all. They do it just to keep being engaged and needed and social for these kind of purposes. And I've talked to several people like that. They were telling me exactly, it just keeps me, you know, feeling needed. And this is exactly something that's very powerful. And you don't have to work at all in a paid employment. You can just find it somewhere else. It can be, you know, helping your grandchildren or, I don't know, keeping some volunteering for some local events in your community, anything that helps you. But you have to have something. If you just retire on the couch to watch Netflix, this can have, you know, negative effects on your health.
That's probably right. Although there are some good Netflix series, but so overall, the takeaway here from what your research has shown, that the number one thing we can do to live longer is have a committed relationship.
Yes, that's true. Relationships are the most important.
All right. Well, where can people find out more about you, your work, and how can they connect with you?
So they can definitely find more about the book on its website. The website's address is www.growingyoungthebook.com, or they can find me on Twitter or Instagram at mzaraska, so it's Zaraska.
All right. Last question. What is the impact you want to have on the world with your work?
I mean, generally, you know, I have a quote here hanging on from Nietzsche on my office door. It says, "He who has a why to live for can bear almost anyhow." And for me, that's why is to slow down the impacts of climate change and make the world, you know, a nicer place this way and better place. And I hope that maybe Growing Young is not directly about climate change, but I do believe that if people care more about the place where they live, about others, and about kindness and helping and relationships, this is also a way in which we'll be kinder to our planets and our environment as well.
That's great. Well, thank you so much for talking with me today. It was very informative and it was a great conversation. So thanks for meeting with me.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you.